A camper van with three battery systems. That's right. My camper van has three battery systems. So I'm going to go in this video, why do I have three different battery systems? What are the benefits of that? How can I use those? And really, to summarize, the big benefit is I never really have to worry about running really out of power or not being able to start the vehicle. Each of the battery systems are automatically and manually interconnected together, either manually or automatically interconnected together. And so let me talk about why. So first of all, let's start with the first two batteries. This is, of course, the starter battery, which in the Sprinter van, the Transit van, are both underneath essentially the driver footwell. They put them there because that way they stay warmer and they're not warmer in the winter, but they're also not going to get as hot in the summertime when they're being driven hard, making deliveries. And so even though they are an AGM battery, they're still going to be heat cycled much more if they're in the engine bay. And so the battery will last a lot longer. And that's been true, I think, in most people that have Sprinter vans. The batteries typically last somewhere between 7 to 10 years or even longer. So quite a long time for a typical commercial heavy use starter van. That's the factory AGM starter battery that's under the footwell. And that's essentially where all the main electrical connections are that gets distributed from that on out. That's where the alternator comes in and so forth. My van also, I ordered it brand new with the auxiliary battery, really just to make an auxiliary battery connection easier. What that provides is a second auxiliary battery, exactly the same size. It is in the engine bay. It does provide a separate connection that's under the driver's seat base where all the electrical is, for the most part, in Transits, ProMasters, and Sprinters. And all the electronics is inside, again, makes it in some ways easier to get to, but in some ways harder. You have to lift the seat off, but all the electronics is all right there. It's a good central location. And what the auxiliary factory Sprinter battery provides is really the auxiliary battery connection. It's a pretty substantial connection. I want to say it's either 100 or 200 amp connection. I can't remember what it is now. It's been 4 or 5 years since I connected to it in this van. Everything's worked flawlessly and perfectly since, but it does provide that connection. And what that relay does, solenoid that's activated by the starter, is it disconnects the auxiliary battery except for when the engine's running. Once the engine starts, the auxiliary battery connects, and all connects up pretty much instantaneously once the engine starts. So both those batteries become connected. What I do then is I connect from that to my house battery. So therefore, once the auxiliary battery is connected, the engine's running, it has electricity power, it's going to now flow to my house battery. But I didn't want it flowing immediately, and the reason why, because it puts a big load on the system right away. I wanted to have a little bit of a delay there. And so I put in a delay, in that I have a solenoid that's also activated by relay off the factory solenoid. So the factory solenoid triggers that. And that then I have a countdown timer, and that countdown timer allows me to set what that time interval is. In my case, what I did is I set it for about a minute and a half. So after the engine started, about a minute and a half later, it will now connect the alternator to my house battery. This does a couple of things. One is, because I have lithium batteries, most people would say, oh, you need to have a DC to DC charger to get the right charge voltage. Well, it's going to get a charge voltage, just certainly above what Battleborn suggests, or in the range that they suggest, and certainly above the minimum threshold for it to get charged, as well within that range. It doesn't need a DC to DC charger. The DC to DC charger really provides a second benefit, and in my opinion, really the main benefit, in that it actually really protects the alternator from too much load at once, or is really probably the main thing. By me having two batteries, two big AGM batteries, and also that solenoid, that relay, it really protects the alternator from having a big hit all at once, and also limits it. And I'll tell you how I limited that a little bit. But the main thing it does, it also, all this gives me I ability to interconnect them all manually as well. So let me go into that. So we dive in here behind the driver's seat. And I have the relay and main connection from the auxiliary batteries all pretty much right here. But I wanted also a manual connection. So I have a manual battery switch right here, Blue Seas battery switch.
And this is, I've got labeled, you can see basically auxiliary and starter battery. I have an auxiliary right now, which means that when that auxiliary battery connects, it will flow power to this switch from the auxiliary battery to my house battery. I'll show you where that runs, but in a minute here. But if I ever want to connect to the starter battery, I can connect to the starter battery. Now I can also turn them off, and I can also interconnect them. So in the event that for some reason my starter battery goes dead, I can use auxiliary battery to interconnect by interconnecting these two. If my house battery is connected, it'll also then bring that power here, and I can also manually disconnect the house battery from here. So if I needed to, I could use the house battery to go to the starter battery to give it a charge and start it. I could also use auxiliary battery to go to the starter battery and create a charge and or start it. These two batteries are sized exactly the same, so either one could be used for starting, and that connection is sizable enough to do that. From here, my output of this battery switch, those wires run underneath the seat bases here, and there's actually a wire chase that runs right along here, and those wires run through there. And these are number 2-aught wires that run all the way through here. But then they go underneath this seat base, and then I also have them running right through this trim piece here. I've got those wires and a couple of wires running through. It's part of why I have this big trim piece. And I talked about this in my flooring video, which you can go back to and watch and see a little bit, learn a bit more about how I did that. They then go into this cabinet here, where they tie into my main electrical panel, positive and negative, and then of course I have this battery switch here. And so some of you have probably seen this in some of my other videos, or I've mentioned it, but in this video I'll talk a little more in detail what's underneath that seat base in a moment here. But this switch here obviously allows me to bring in my auxiliary battery, right, which is coming in. You can see they're combined right now to my house battery, right? And it's normally combined with my house battery because, again, there's that delay after the engine starts, the auxiliary battery gets connected to the starter battery, then I have my time delay, which after that time delay, it'll then start feeding power through this switch, which will feed my house batteries. So generally the house and the auxiliary and the starter battery are all disconnected when the van is sitting idle. Except when the alternator is running, they're all three getting charged. And yet, if I ever want to, I can always disconnect them at any time. And so this is a make before break. These can get disconnected anytime. And I can also disconnect them here for safety. So shut them off. And that way I know they're safe when I go to work on them. So let's go in what's underneath the seat base over here. And I'll show you how I did the delay on that, on the connection passing through, which is not needed, but it's a nice thing to do. You do see the voltage drop in the alternator when the auxiliary battery gets connected and the starter battery, of course, because they're charging themselves back up after the start. But also as the house batteries get hit, it causes the alternator to fluctuate a little bit to find kind of where the voltage is. So this gives it a chance to really, get everything synchronized and stuff before I connect the house battery, which I found is worked really well. The alternator just doesn't even really change voltage at that point. It stays very stable up at that 14.2, which is pretty much what its standard output is, 14.2 volts. So, which is, again, the Battleborne batteries, their spec is anything really above 13.6 is going to get a charge, and really it almost doesn't matter really when it gets, as long as it's in that range above 13.6 to, I think it's 14.6. Jack Battleborne specs, I'm going to have memory on that. But as long as they're in a range, those batteries are going to get charged. And that's how I've done it, and I'm going to go in now what's underneath that seat base right here and how I connected those together and made that work. All right, so underneath the seat base here, I want to point out a few things. One is, these are the standard circuits that are come with all Sprinters, and you have an ignition only on and always on. And so this one, the ignition only turns, of course, on when you have an ignition actually all the way turned to the on after, meaning you started the vehicle. The always on, what I've done is a few things. So one is, I have a factory auxiliary battery. The factory auxiliary battery
comes in here. I went ahead and I placed these labels on here just to make it clear. So anytime I come in here and do any work or have done any work, it's all clear to me. And this is obviously where the starter battery connects. These then run over into basically a relay and a connection port so that the auxiliary battery only turns on once the ignition is fired. And then you have your output from that. On the output of that, it's a little hard to see in here, but I put two MRBF fuses. And one of these goes for the top one here. Is 100 amp output that goes to my charge relay. I'll go through that in a minute. The other one goes through just a little small secondary fuse, and this is just for a couple of things that I've added over time. One here is my ham radio, but I had a couple of, you know, so I just kind of left that so I can add more things in the future. And that's it. That's my output of my auxiliary. Then, so the main output auxiliary, which goes to feed and charge my house battery, goes through this relay here. And this is a 200 amp relay. I have in here a little circuit board that's a time delay. And this time delay allows me to adjust the timing from anywhere from about a second to like many, many minutes that this will trigger. And I have this triggered off the ignition. So I can set it to a certain amount of time. And right now I have it set to a little over a minute, and I'll show you that in a minute as to why I have it set to that. And then once it triggers, it goes ahead and goes through into my battery switch. And you can see in the back here, I have it labeled house, auxiliary, and starter. And because I bring in another feed from my starter battery over here into this A and B battery selector switch. So I'll show you a picture of this. And the reason why is this allows me then to interconnect my house, my auxiliary, or my starter battery, or any combination of the three together. So typically the way this would work is that when I start the vehicle, after about a minute, after its time delay, it triggers open, and then that allows the starter battery and auxiliary battery to basically get charged up and synchronized in their voltages before I connect into my house battery bank, which is a much bigger battery. And then that goes and allows a charge going out to my house battery bank. Now, if for some reason or another, I had a problem, electrical problem, and I needed to interconnect, add in my auxiliary battery or take away my house battery and you run off the auxiliary battery, I could do that through this battery switch back here. Or I could also interconnect the auxiliary and the starter battery, or the house and the starter battery, or all three if my starter battery died, so I can actually still start. So I have basically three, I do have three battery systems, and any three can be used to charge the starter battery or start the vehicle. Now granted, that starter battery cable is a little bit smaller because that's the size, you know, it's not designed to actually really starting a vehicle is only going to be a very short intermittent high current event, very short, so it doesn't need as big of a cable. But so I could run over a pretty significant charge coming out over to my starter battery should that be needed. A couple more things I wanted to point out is I've added some lights that turn on when I open the doors, and sort of just give me a little extra light. Over here, I've got another one. You can also see I've got my ham radio mounted over here on this side. That's a convenient spot where it's out of the way. It's got a remote up here in the dash, which I've gone over in my cabin video. And then all the rest is all the standard Mercedes stuff, but you can see down here I also have a bunch of thin slate. It may be difficult to see, but I have a bunch of thin slate that's stuffed down at the bottom of this because there was quite a bit of noise that does come up through this. So you have to remember the seat base is metal. It's bolted right to the floor of the vehicle, which without any insulation. So by doing that, that gives me a lot more quieter driving experience, and also helps to not have as much heat or heat loss through the seat base here, or gained through the seat base when it's hot outside. So that helps, especially on the passenger side, where that is where exhaust runs underneath it. And so that seat can actually get hotter when you're driving for.
I hope this video was helpful to you and it's given you some ideas of what you can do in your camper van conversion. And I certainly look forward to sharing more. I'm going to go over more details about my electrical system and the different sub panels I did and why I did it that way and the convenience of that, as well as also how I mounted the four battle-borne batteries underneath the van and the plumbing system here fairly soon. So look forward to sharing more. Thanks so much. Please do subscribe and share with others who probably could also gain some value from watching these videos.